Betsy Fisher has been dancing all her life and is likely to continue. She performs, choreographs, and teaches internationally. For her, dance is a matter of life and breath. I have a couple of other comments to add to that. Betsy is Professor Emerita and a former Professor of Dance, Department of Theater and Dance at the University of Hawaii at Mānoa. That sounds like that happened a long time ago. It actually just happened last December. Although she took a very good break because she then headed off on this amazing hiking tour and basically made a full separation, but luckily she's back with us today. I also just wanted to mention that I've known Betsy for a very long time as an artistic collaborator, as a colleague at the university. And a couple of things I want to mention, first of all, is just her visibility in so many different ways at the university and also in the community. She is a marvelous dancer, a magnificent dancer, and has continued a career for, 50 years now, more in dancing, has participated in New York professional companies, she's toured the world, and she also has a PhD, and as I remember, your PhD is from an institution that actually gave you a sword. Is that right? Are you a sword one?
No.
Finland, right?
Finland. Yeah. I got a purple satin top hat.
That'll do it. But the other thing I want to mention is during the period of time that she's been a colleague, she has made sure that she has invested somehow or other 100% of her time in teaching, 100% of her time in advising, 100% of her time in producing, and 100% of her time continually dancing. She's maintained an active dance career with companies like Monkey Waterfall and other opportunities in the community. So she's been a continual contributor to our community, to the university, and generations of dancers that she's directed and encouraged and trained. The other thing I'd just like to mention in relation to this is that they did a show a number of years ago through a group called Horse's Mouth, which actually put together dancers, a whole range of dancers from Hawaii, in which each one of them ended up telling a story of their life as a dancer, which was punctuated first by you saw them warming up at one side of the stage, they told their story, and then they sort of moved out. And Betsy told one of the stories in there. And I'm sitting there because I'm at the center thinking, dance and biography. How would these go together? They're going together in a very interesting way here. Dance, and then you've got biography. Well, just before COVID smashed down on us in 2020, there was going to be a show with Yuki Shiroma and Betsy Fisher, which was going to be a show in which both of them in some ways reflected on their careers. What came out of that is the piece that we've asked Betsy to talk about today, which is a magnificent, basically, dance recap of her life in which it integrates speaking, music, dance, and also a remarkable sense of quotation of the various influences and dancers and dances that she's been involved with over the years. So when I saw that and appreciated that and recognized this was a way of bringing more things together in terms of the way that a life could be represented than you could almost imagine, I just asked Betsy if she'd be willing to talk to us about how she did that and how she pulled it off. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce my colleague, Betsy Fisher.
Are we on?
We're on.
Well, thank you, Craig. That was a I'm humbled. Thanks very much. So yes, and thank you, Caroline, and for all of your help here. And I'm really happy to be able to talk about dance in terms of biography and being in this room in the Center for Biographic Research. And it's made me go back into this piece that I made and think about it with a little bit different lens. So I appreciate that opportunity as well. So the piece is called Dog Years. And like the little flyer says it, I was thinking about how they say that for every 1 year a human lives, that a dog lives for 7 years. And if that's the case, do dancers then live in dog years? As a joke, but also it's kind of true. Because they always, you know, as you age, at least in the Western canon of ballet and modern dance, it sort of feel like, oh, well, you know, you're going to stop that and move on in your life. Well, that's not true in every other form of dance that I can think of. It, you don't age out of it, but in the dance practices I've been involved with primarily, you do generally do age out of it, but I'm not aging out of it. It's just not happening. So I had to deal with this question about dance and aging, and that's where dog ears came from. And that's a picture of a dog. Okay, how do I advance like this?
You can just
okay. Yeah. So I was thinking about this presentation and I remembered this picture of myself as a kid. I never wanted to do anything else but dance. That's always been my dream and my goal, and it continues to be that. But there's a lot of dance biographies out there. And these are just from the modern dance world, but there's, I mean, I can't even imagine how many, if you're talking about hula, how many dances are about, are biographies. And I just mentioned a few here, Martha Graham's Seraph Dialogue. When she did that in the 40s, it was quite a groundbreaking thing because she presented Joan of Arc at three different times in her life simultaneously. So you had Joan the Warrior, the Maid, and some other aspect of her life happening simultaneously, which you can do in music and you can do in dance. You can show this kind of simultaneity of phases of life at the same time. It's hard to do as a soloist, but you can, but you have to have your arm be one thing and your other arm be another thing. So it's a little bit tough. It gets kind of postmodern in that way. And Doris Humphrey did one for the famous bullfighter. And then much more, that was also in the 40s, and much more recently, a listing of some others. They, each one of these examples started differently. Some started with text. One that's not listed is Martha Graham's Letter to the World, which was about Emily Dickinson. And she, of course, started with the poetry, and the poetry is read on stage. So that was a definitely use of text. Doris Humphrey's piece didn't use text. These other pieces, the more recent pieces, Sean Dorsey, all the way through Janice Brenner, they started with text, as far as I know. They started with text and then the dancing came after that. Dog ears started with dancing. It started with dancing. That picture there is by Hawkins Biggins on the Big Island. So anyway, dog ears started with dance. But text jumped in pretty quickly, and I'll talk about how all of that developed. So that's another photo by Hawkins Biggins, also on the Big Island. And I call the piece Dog Years, A Life in Dance to be Continued. And I had the concept choreography and text. I used several different musical scores, Max Richter, Faré, all the way through those that you see. And I also used a poem by Billy Collins. That's the concluding dance section of Blue Moon. So like Craig mentioned, I quote a lot of choreographers. I quote verbally, who do I quote in there? I quote Martha Graham verbally and Alwyn Nicolai. The rest, and I also quote them in terms of movement, but most of these are movement quotes. So Balanchine, I quote, two of his pieces, La Sonnambula and Serenade. Bausch, I quote Café Müller, Blossom, Dad's Ties. Janice Brenner created a solo for me that I quote. Corrali is, of course, Giselle, Mark Dendy, Beat, Isadora Duncan, Mother, a bunch of pieces of mine from the past. Fokine is Dying Swan, Bob Fosse is Sweet Charity, which I never performed in some of these, by the way, but they were pieces that just lingered with my memory. Lotta Gosler, a couple of her little pieces, Graham Night Journey, Hanya Holm, Homage to Mahler, Doris Humphrey Night Journey, I mean, Night Spell, Kurt Jost, Green Table, Jose Limon, Choreographic Offering, Murray Lewis, a bunch of them, because I danced with him for a bunch of years. Nijinsky is Afternoon of a Fawn, Nikolai Tribe, and something else probably. Gret Palooka, I don't quote her choreography, but I quote a line drawing that Kandinsky made of her dancing. So I include here. Four Little Swans, Michael Peters, of course, the Thriller piece that he did for Michael Jackson, Carl Schaefer from Parade, Shapir and Smith for Doug and All, Richard Siegel, a piece for Janice, Anna Sokolow Rooms, Helen Tamira's Negro Spirituals, Paul Taylor, a thing he does in several of his pieces. Tudor would be Lilac Garden, Jardin à Lillet. Mariana Fogelsong is Praludian. Kevin Ward is a piece called Man Mountain Modine. And Mary Wigman, Abschied und Dank and Hexentanz. So some of these pieces, Dora Hoyer, that would be Effectos Humanos. So some of these pieces would be familiar to a lot of people. Some of them undoubtedly you never heard of, but they all live in my body. So a long time ago, I sort of realized a dancer's body, at least this body, is an archive. It's its own archive where all of these things are stored. Movement memories and also the stories that are attached to those movement memories. So creating, actually these photos come from Finland when I was a Fulbright scholar there at the Teatteri Korkea Koulutanssitaten Laatos, wonderful experience. So I first wanted to say that doing this via PowerPoint is really weird for me. It's more normal for me to be dancing than talking about all of this stuff, but this is a challenge that I embrace. So how and why did Dog Years happen? This was going on 4 years ago now, and I was chair of the Department of Theater and Dance, and I was kind of going crazy, as I think every chair does every day. And I was spending so much time problem solving and putting out fires and trying to figure out computer things that I had not spending enough time where I belonged, which is the dance studio. And I had some very intense questions about dancing and aging. And what was I doing? Should I do that thing and just retire from dance career gracefully and move on to other things? But I had this desperate calling to dance. And I just wanted to know if this desire and this need to dance would ever end. And I had the only way I could answer that question was to get in the studio and dance it out. So I did not have the intention of making a piece of choreography to perform. I just needed to excavate myself and figure out what I was going to do with my life moving forward and this university job and the whole thing. So there's this little funky studio that they're about to tear down called Luna Lilo, and I just booked it there, and I made it my business to get in there twice a week. Come hell or high water, I was in there working. And what happened when I was in there was not talking or writing, but dancing. And what happened was these fragments that I had just talked about in the slide before, or from those dances, started to just bubble out. And it wasn't conscious, it wasn't a plan. It just happened. And they started to sequence, they started to go with one another. And it just was always about the physicality, the dancing, and accessing these memories, that these physical kinetic memories that were inside of me. And so that then this joke I'd had in my head about dogs living for, you know, seven years of dog and 1 year of human life, I realized, well, that has to be the title, is Dog Years. And it was just this whole bunch of recollections. And it I don't know how they came, and I don't know why they came in the order that they came. But once it started spilling out, I had all this material. And with those things come stories, you know, like and several of the stories I tell in the piece when I perform it. So that's when the text started entering, and I started writing that stuff down. And then a lot of stuff I started writing down, and then I started accessing that as part of the creating as well. So writing and text definitely came in there from the action of doing, if that makes sense to you guys. So what I end up with was this like crazy quilt. Caroline, you even know what a crazy quilt is. She's from North Carolina. So it's where you have a bunch of pieces of fabric laying around in your chest or your house or something, and you just stitch them together to make a quilt. And that's what happened, is I made this crazy quilt. But it's also like a pastiche, because one thing, you can see one thing through the other, and it, or a collage. So it has that kind of dynamic to it as well. So this picture is of myself, and it actually, Craig, is from a performance of The Horse's Mouth that was done in New York City in honor of Murray Lewis. So it's not from the one that was done here in Honolulu at Kennedy, but another Horse's Mouth. And I told a story about, that's Murray Lewis, with whom I worked for years, and he was a huge influence in my life, in my dancing, and for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people, not certainly not me alone. And so that's a picture from that Horse's Mouth celebration in one of the costumes from a piece I did of his that I danced a little bit of as part of that Horse's Mouth presentation. So it seemed fitting to have this picture because of the memories and the dancing. So all of this stuff, it literally just kind of whooshed out of me. The thinking is, when I think about what thinking is, Nikolai, who is Murray Lewis's partner artistically and personally, and a mentor of mine, certainly, he used to say that it took just as long for a person's physical body to evolve as their brain. And we so often privilege the brain and use the body as just sort of a thing to help the brain walk around. And when in actuality, the whole body is incredibly intelligent. And Nikolai was talking about this long before Howard Gardner and his multiple intelligences stuff, but it's kind of along the same lines of understanding. So yeah, there were other kinds of, I don't want to say forces, but there were other kinds of actions at play here. And it wasn't just my brain sorting things, this part, this intelligence sorting out, it was just stuff in my body. And as I progressed in this process, it was the dance that told me what to do. And I felt like I kind of just had, in some ways, part of me had to get out of the way of allowing that other thing to progress and happen. I hope that makes sense. This picture is by Carl Hefner, and the mask is by Michael Harada. And I have to apologize to Michael, because this photo was made before he painted the mask. After a year or so, we decided he needed to paint the mask. The mask looks different now. And it's from a piece from Mary Wigman's Hexentanz, which was part of a whole other project I did. And I quote that piece in Dog Years. But anyway, so the movement choices started to select themselves by the way I was trying to explain before. So something would happen, some kind of a quote would happen here, which would remind me, oh, this thing by a piece by Mariana Fuglsang, all of a sudden that reminded me of something that Anthony Tudor choreographed, which reminded me of something that Bob Fosse choreographed. So it kind of did that. And it just kind of happened that way. And then, so I had these chunks of movement that then almost phrased themselves together. They stuck themselves together because it felt like something in this arm led to something in that hip, led to something in my torso or my leg or whatever. And then I did kind of mess around with it and repeat it in different ways or different facings or faster or slower or traveling it somewhere because it felt like I needed to be somewhere else on the stage at that moment or in the studio at that moment. And so the narrative, the section, so it, the whole thing started to form itself into these sections. And each of these sections was addressing a different aspect of aging and of my dance career. So the section, there's a section with some a cattle auction sound of the cattle auctioneer selling cows, you know, at one of those places probably in Texas or something. And I chose that music because I wanted to do a section about what it's like to be at an audition, what it's like to constantly be selling yourself as a dancer or a performer, or really anything, right? You're constantly trying to get your idea across and get someone to fetch it, you know? And so that all of the stuff that related to that kind of chunked together. And then I realized I had a bunch of stuff that dealt with death. And that I put in the second dancing section of the piece to Gabriel Fauré's song to the dead princess, to the
right,
yeah, what's it called, anyway, a Fauré piece about a tribute to a dead princess. I'm sorry, I can't remember that name. And then I realized I had a bunch of movement quotes from dances that dealt with death in one way or another, so those got chunked together. I have a whole section about injury, and you know, so it started to form like that. And it, so then this narrative started to happen, but not in terms of like a consecutive years, you know, this year, then this year, then this year narrative. It was more abstract than that, or just this seemed to go best next to that, seemed to know go best next to that. And it also had to do with the overall arc of the piece, when I wanted to bring it down and when I wanted to get funny. I mean, when I first started putting this together, I thought everyone was just going to be laughing the whole time, but that's actually not what happens, which is curious. I mean, I think there's some laughter for sure, but it also gets into some other territory. And so this whole arc of the piece happens. And like I started asking this question, you know, what am I going to do with this crazy desire and this need to dance? Is that ever going to end? And I've been working on this dance now for a long time, because it gets to be like a year or so later, I'm still working on it. And now it really is turning into a dance. Then I get into the studio there at that funky Luna Lilo studio, and I'm working on this section, which became the end section. And I walk to the front of the space and I say, will this desire and this need to dance ever end? And I really didn't know. And then it came out, no, it's never going to end, because it never began. It simply always has been. And that was not premeditated. That just happened the way the whole piece happened. Yeah, so this whole dance just kept teaching me stuff as I went along. And that was a big one.
Death of Melisande.
Say that again?
Death of Melisande, is that the one you're looking for, Fauré?
No, it's something about the dead princess. Yeah, yeah.
Get it?
Yeah, you'll get it. So then we come to performance, and like Craig said, initially, Yuki Shiroma and I were going to split a bill at the Lab Theater, and we were going to call it Two Dancers, No Pirouettes. But unfortunately, COVID had other ideas and shut everything down. So that was too bad. But on the other hand, we didn't have classes at the university, and I had the big studio to myself for like months, which, so then I got back in with this whole dog years and kept working on it and working on it and adding things, taking things away, and refining it and having more questions about it. And I would invite people in and they would see it and they'd give me some comments, and made a few trips to New York and worked with some trusted folks there. And it just started kind of going through a sieve, and I ended up with dog years, then got to perform it. And I always feel that performing something is the beginning. That's when the research starts all over again, because it's when you're there in performance that's when you discover what's happening. All the rest of the stuff is just prep. And so it's always a beginning. It's always a process of discovery and rediscovery. And like I write there, it's alive. So this picture is from something that I actually don't quote in Dog Years, but I like the picture. And it's from something Craig undoubtedly remembers that we did at Mark's Garage. A piece called Legal Alien was part of, what was the name of that show? We did a lot of shows with Monkey Waterfall.
Is that the solo show?
I can't remember. Anyway, we did a bunch, and several of them were there at Mark's. But So performing is the jam. It's what it's all what it became about. It started not there. It started as these really personal questions, and it turned into Dog Ears, the show. So you want to play a clip? Let's play, and I'd like to start and stop. This is from the first dance section to music by Max Richter called Infrared. And and I want to give you an idea. Can they hear me over the music when it goes?
Should be.
Okay. Yeah. So you can just play it, and I'll tell you. And I can stop it there by clicking.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I just gave a quote by Martha Graham. And so I gave that kind of gesture like, huh, I don't know. But then that took me into this hand gesture. And then reaching downstage. And that hand gesture, which started like, huh, I don't know. You'll see, that right there is a quote from Murray Lewis from Lenny and the Heartbreakers video Dream Boy. And then, that reminded me of Serenade, which is this very famous section from George Balanchine's Serenade, I think it's 1946. And then I quote, here is a piece I choreographed a long time ago. And I started feeling like, well, this is kind of a mime thing. You know, okay, well, now, of course, I have to be in a box because that's what mimes do. And then I'm like, wait a minute, where's my wallet? Okay, then I'm quoting Mariana Fuglsang in her piece, Preludian, which I performed many times. Then I go into this thing with my hand behind, grabbing my forearm in the back. That's from Anthony Tudor's Jardin à l'Allée. And then I repeat the hand. And that reminded me of Anna Sokolo, with whom I worked a bunch. And she used to talk about the palm and about the beautiful Israeli hand. And this whole palm thing became a motif throughout the whole piece of Dog Ears, because the palm is like, you know, you read your lifelines, and it's like a stigmata. It's all sorts of things. So this is just reiterating Fuglsang here. This is all kind of direct quote from her Preludian. And this I just added. And this is from Nikolai's Tribe, a solo I performed a bunch. And this is from Anna Sokolo's Rooms, from a solo called Escape. I'm doing it differently, but it's her idea. A little nod to Hula. And that's not Escape. Now, that just made me think of a clock and about the passage of time in those old movies where you see the clock going faster and faster and faster and faster to show that time is passing quickly. And this is a quote from a piece I made called Echo to music by Ernie Provencher. That's a quote from Murray Lewis's Schubert. This is from Honda Holmes' Homage to Mahler. Then I go to Murray Lewis's Glances, back to Homage to Mahler by Hanya Holm. Which looped me here into Doris Humphrey's Night Spell, this little bit here. I start thinking about dogs. then Mary Wigman's Hexen class, Witch Dance. And this is just stuff I made up. And this is from Mark Dendy's Beat. Back to my piece Echo. Reiterating Marie Lewis, a phrase from Marie Lewis's piece called Schubert to the Trout Quintet. And this is from Dora Hoyer's Effectus Humanus, a section called Eitelkeit. And this goes back to Marie Lewis, a piece called Rebels. And then this just reminded me of being pissed off and fighting. And this isn't a quote from a piece, but it's a kind of movement that Murray Lewis did, this kind of stop action stuff. And this from a piece that Janice Brennan choreographed for me, this hip thing. And that's this Rondeschon thing that I made up, sort of. This is also from Anna Sokolow's Escape, but she didn't do it traveling, and she has on a dress. Back to Echo. And this is from Helen Tamiris's Negro Spirituals, section called Go Down Moses. Martha Graham, Night Journey. That's a piece from Judy Allen. Okay, now we're back to, okay, that's Bob Fosse. Sweet Charity, Big Spender. Back to Tudor's Jardin. Back to Fosse. Another section from Dora Hoyer's Effectus Humanus, and this is just me pulling myself around, feeling like I was being thrown around by other forces. And this is from Murray Lewis's Geometrics.
Down, guillotine. So, do we dance?
Okay, I say, so do dancers live in dog years? Yeah, so that's how that little section ends. Yeah, so how are we doing for time? Maybe we can show best shot.
Okay.
Okay, so this happens later on in the piece, and when I'm getting into a whole thing about competition and actually not just in dancing, you know, when you really have to prove yourself over and over and over and over again, and even in my position here at the university, how often that was the case, where you'd have to go in and talk to some higher person, mucky muck, and once again, prove the value of something that over and over, and you just keep taking your knocks, you keep taking your lumps. And that's where...
Oh, I know where this is going.
What?
I know where this is going.
Yeah, okay, so let's play this one. Do okay. Oh, so this is Pat Benatar.
Yeah.
You know, it takes a lot to really last in this vocation. But three things really jump to the surface.
Okay, so I said it really takes a lot to last in this vocation, but three things jump to the surface.
You've got to have a sense of humor. It's incredibly helpful when you figure out that optimism is a survival mechanism. That communication or that dialogue between utter vulnerability and being one tough.
Okay. quotes, and as the dog years goes on, I still do some quotes, like that's from Shapiro and Spitz, the Doug and all, but it becomes less and less quote oriented. Tell a story about this little section here. That little section came from we were on tour back with when I was in Murray Lewis's company, on tour in Italy, and I had bought these really sexy boots. They're high heels, black boots with these, you know, Italian gorgeous boots. And after the show, the dressing room was upstairs, and there was this like circular staircase you had to go down, and there's a whole bunch of people down at the bottom of the stairs and the show, and there's Murray and his sort of entourage of good-looking Italian men and stuff. And so I'm coming down this metal circular staircase in these boots. So down come the boots, and Murray's like, oh, there's the dancer in her boots and all of that, and of course I tripped. So, yeah, best shot. Oh, there's a lot more behind that, but maybe best not to go through it right now. So after this section, after best shot, I go into a thing where I say, I want to thank you all for this lifetime achievement award. Well, of course, there's no lifetime achievement award in dancing, but, you know. And then I go into a kind of serious thing about thanking my teachers. Who I genuinely, genuinely thank and have so much respect for everything they managed to pull me through. So I give a whole section about that gratitude, and that leads me into a bunch of other stuff. And I do a section to Patsy Cline singing I Fall to Pieces, which leads into a thing about injury and about a whole section about, you know, what if instead of looking like this, I look like this, or this look like this. And as a dancer, you're facing yourself, at least in ballet modern dance stuff, you're facing yourself in very little clothing in front of a mirror all the time. And you're always thinking, oh, shoot, you know, maybe this could look like this, or this should, you know, you're always trying to, you know, what if this looked like this? What if this looked like this? And that just grows into a whole crazy thing there. So anyway, the piece just progresses and progresses. And I go through a couple of iterations of, You know, I say it like at the end of a painter's career, there's a canvas. At the end of a sculptor's career, there's art to walk around. And at the end of a dancer's career, there's arthritis. And then going to, that's when Patsy Cline's I Fall to Pieces happens. And then the next time another iteration of that comes in, I say after a lawyer's career, there's a bonus. And after a firefighter's career, there's a pension. After an accountant's career, there's a 401k. And after a dancer's career, there are memories. And then go into Blue Moon and a piece that I had choreographed earlier, but kind of tweaked for this. So that's kind of a rundown. I guess we have time to look at another clip. You want to look at Techno Dog Bark? Yeah, so this happens early on in the piece.
Dog wheels. Dancer wheels, dogs and dancer. Collars, leashes, owners, LA slippers, sweatpants, choreographer. Training, obedience school. Technique class, bad dog, great show, good dog.
So all of these are moving quotes. That's a big mom thing, another flossy thing. Choreographed Bob brings in a very long from Doris Humphrey. Martha Grand exercises. If I say sit, and then I go down and do Grand stuff. That's from Kevin Ward. That's Marcel Kaczynski, sort of. So I said beg, so I'm begging the audience for applause, and they usually do. This particular bow is one I'm copying from someone. He took this film very seriously. And this long plié with the fingers here, that's from Murray Lewis's Day Number. That's Graham again. Me being jerked around by the leash, by the collar, which I often felt like was happening as a dancer. That's a four little swans, petty pot, only my arms and legs. And that's just stuff I put in there. Okay, so that's that. So that's another little section of dog years. And I think now we could do questions if anybody has any.
Okay. Thank you so much. I was lucky enough to see that live and actually see it in a rehearsal before that. So it's great to see it the third time. Again, being impressed on how little I got of it the first two times I saw it.
It's kind of packed. Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm, I'll start with an initial. Do we have questions?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, why don't we just go right to there? I've got some too, but I have other ways of being able to ask them. Okay, just a second here. And by the way, I think Pavan for a Dead Princess.
Pavan for a Dead Princess, thank you. That's the foray.
No,
with all of these.
No, it's the Ravel.
Oh, Ravel. Ah, Ravel. And that was this sections about death.
Okay. All right. Let me just see here. Okay, the chat's over here. Okay. The first question is coming from, oh yeah. And Ernie said in that it was Ravel.
Oh, Ernie, thanks a lot, dude.
Okay.
Yeah.
The first question is, do you still perform here in Hawaii? If so, how can we get on your email list for performances?
Oh,
that's the first one.
I perform as often as I can. And hopefully with Yuki, Shiroma, and Monkey Waterfall, we don't have anything scheduled right now, but probably that. And I'm always eager to do Dog Years. I have another whole dance. I have a whole other thing about dance and environmentalism and nature that I also do. And that's mostly in video at this point, but send your email into here at Center for Biographical Research and I'll make sure to let you know. Thank you.
Okay. A few other just general comments. Mara Miller saying that was all amazing. Thank you. And from Lori Barron, aloha, Betsy, and everyone celebrating today. Mahalo to all who made it possible, including Zoom Tech Kokua folks. That's Caroline. Also from Lori, that was astonishing. Mahalo nui, Betsy. All right. And then,
I'd do the same
comment. Okay. I'm going to follow up. I was going to ask about that notion of question of quotation, just more generally. Because in dance more generally, I would guess and to a degree know that people assemble it out of their teachers, assemble out of various, and the quotation is a not only a very common but a really formative dimension of dance. I was just wondering, I found absolutely fascinating that notion that somehow or other the piece emerged out of the quotations. So I was just wondering a little bit more about your process there. You were saying it was coming out of the out of your body in mm-hmm. the studio, but were there other times where you were literally sort of thinking through what you would need to quote, or did you ever go at it that way, or was it always something that emerged out of the studio?
It all came out of the doing. It came out of the physical doing. That's what led me to the next thing each time. I didn't like make a roster of dances that I would want to do. I would just find myself in a situation and go, oh, wow, that really reminds me of Sweet Charity. And oh, that really reminds me. But with the pieces that I hadn't performed, like I never performed Fosse work or Petty yeah. Paw or that. But I've seen the work so often and it's so imprinted in me in another way that I was just reminded. So that was probably more visual than physical because I'm remembering the visual of it as opposed to it residing somewhere in my muscle memory.
Mm-hmm. And when did you start? I was lucky enough, one of the other projects to be writing some words for something we were putting together, that show at Kennedy, right?
Mm.
The environmental one.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, that one. Yeah
okay. But the other thing I was just wondering about was at what point did you start realizing that, did it come from horse's mouth or when was the point where you realized you were going to start writing text? I mean, how long have you been doing that or when did that come in or when did you realize you were going to be integrating text into the dance?
Well, you know, I didn't even think about horse's mouth. Maybe somewhere in the back of my self I was thinking about horse's mouth, but that didn't occur to me until you just said that. When the text came pretty quick, because as soon as I started having all of these different movement sequences from different choreographers and then they started to kind of lump themselves together, then it's when the stories came out, the stories that connected to those movements and to those little phrases. And the people connected to those stories. And as you know from seeing the whole piece, I tell some of those stories, some of them pretty horrendous.
Well, that's why I always think in terms of how Horse's Mouth, because the story you told in Horse's Mouth ends up in Dog Years.
Oh, which story? Because I've done Horse's Mouth a bunch of times. Yeah, which one?
The one you did here, it was the one of being basically the toast of Europe in Paris and then getting back to go ahead.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah. That story is, we were on tour and performing in Paris in this beautiful theater and many encores, and we had to do encores, which is really different in modern dance. So we'd have all these ovations and all that stuff and really great and embassy receptions and champagne and all of that. And the tour ends, we fly back to New York and I have to go to the unemployment office, of course, and come right back to the street, to the ground. And the woman at the unemployment office said, hey, you know, maybe if you had any skills, you'd have a job, you know? So I was like, okay.
I think that's why that story stayed.
Yeah, that one stayed. I told other stories in other Horse's Mouth, but that's a good story. Yeah, and Dog Years has some others too.
We've got a comment here from Elise Stevens. Hi, Betsy. Hi, Betsy. Mahalo for sharing. Such a great concept that dancers think about, and I love the process you went through. It's a great representation of what you love and your experiences. What's next for you? By the way, I'm a previous student of Betsy's.
Elise is a wonderful dancer and choreographer. She was here for a while. What's next? What's very next is I'm going to be a grandma. Ernie and I are going to be grandparents. So that's what's very next. But there's some possibility of Dog Years on the East Coast, so and some other places. So there's some irons in the fire with Dog Years. And I have this ongoing dance and nature project where I go to pretty extraordinary places and improvise in those places. And I have a bunch of these video clips. I'm not sure where that's going. It's just, you know, it's like the early Dog Years. It's just a bunch of material. I'm not sure what's going to happen with it.
Yeah.
And I hope to do more collaborations with other dancers here in Honolulu.
Okay. And a couple of other things I want to share. Cindy Franklin, please thank Betsy for this talk and best of all the dance clips with the wonderful attending stories. So I'm going to make sure you were doing that. And this one's kind of interesting. It's from a biographical standpoint. This is from S. Kurt. Thanks for sharing the Zoom invite. It's good to see what you're up to these days after all these years. I'm going to bet that I'm the only one online that remembers you from that earliest dance photo you shared.
Yeah, well, that's Steve, I think. And we went to elementary school together. And I saw your name on the list there. So yeah, that he lived across the street. Yeah.
Okay. And this is from John Zern. Thank you for this fascinating talk. As I listened and watched, I was thinking about the idea of muscle memory. My mother retired as a professional harpist in part because she said she was losing her muscle memory and wasn't able to perform at her former level. Anything comparable in dance?
Oh yeah. And music too. My husband's a musician and we've talked about that in terms of musicians he works with that are aging and their memory processes and stuff, and it's, you have muscle memory, so it's like riding a bike. They say, you know, you always remember how to ride a bike. And in dance there's all these sequences that go in your, I don't know how, you know, adults learn these sequences, because I've known them, like in ballet, you know, tombe pas de bourrée, you saw it, you know, there are things that are so embedded in you. And I think for a musician, whatever they're playing, it's the same kind of thing. It's in your muscle, it's in your body. And as you age, sometimes that doesn't work the same. But what I maintain is that other things kick in that you can't access when you're younger. And in dance, if you're trying to think of, oh, a dancer has this young body and a dancer has to jump and leap and have high legs and do all those things, well, maybe not that. But there's other things that can happen when you're older, when you don't have that same muscle memory, when you don't have that same level of physical stuff, there's other things that can kick in. And I've heard that in music, and I certainly have seen it in dance. And I hope I have that in me too.
Any other questions there, Carolyn?
Not so far.
Okay. All right. This is a solo piece, right? You also do a lot of collaborative pieces and a group pieces or whatever. Could you just talk about the notion of solitariness in relation to dance? Because when most people think of dance studios, or they're thinking of, there's a bunch of people there, there are other people watching and whatever. How much would you describe this as a solitary process, and how much would you describe it as a kind of collective process, and how does it compare to sort of your career of doing all sorts of pieces?
Well, in a bunch of the solo projects I've done, including Dog Years, but also in the whole German lineage project, which is not entirely but related, I honestly don't feel alone. I feel like I've got my teachers there telling me when I'm messing up. I've got the former directors. I certainly got the music, if there's music. I've got the choreography itself, whether it's being created on the spot improvisationally or in terms of trying to remember it for set choreography or doing someone else's work. I honestly, when it's good, I don't feel alone. When it's right, I don't. I feel like there's so much memory at play that I need, that I find there after many decades of doing this. Yeah. So I don't really feel alone. And on stage, when I'm performing, if I have that alone feeling, it's usually because it's not good. It's not right. It's not good. Mm. Yeah, it's not, I'm not connecting to, it sounds goofy, but I'm not connecting to ancestors. Mm. And those ancestors might be gone dead, or they might be alive, but they're there. And they're kind of everything. And that's a big part of what Dog Years is, right? It's connecting to that type of memory and that type of truth.
There's also a long tradition in life writing studies that really came out of the feminist movement in the 1970s of identifying identity as fundamentally relational. Mm-hmm. And that it's actually how you are feeling or attached to other people, which actually constitutes who you are. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you're almost channeling that, or just being hyper conscious of the fact that that's actually what's composing you.
It is. I mean, to be totally honest about it, and working with other people, which is such a other dancers on stage performing and rehearsing is such a joy. And when that's really good is when you're accessing not necessarily the same people, but you're accessing the same stuff, the same feel, the same vibe, and that's when that's good.
We have a question from Lanning Lee. He's curious, what is the final segment of Dog Years about?
Well, memory. It's about memory, and that's to the Billy Collins poem. And the poem is about the jazz version of the music Blue Moon. And then it's actually Jeff Peterson, who many of you may know, playing Blue Moon. And then I made a recording speaking Billy Collins poetry over that. And yeah, so that's a piece about memory, and it's about losing your memory precisely, and what's left.
All right, and
well, that's the last dance section. Yeah. The whole piece ends with when I just walk down, I have the palm forward again, and I say, well, you know, will this desire and this need to dance ever end? No. Because it never began. It simply always has been.
This is Mara Miller. She's asking, have you performed pieces about trauma? Your death work could have gone there, but to the extent that we saw that part of it, it does not seem to verge on the traumatic, not that it should, So this is, I think, a separate issue, though, of course, trauma can be related to death.
Well, yeah. But no, I didn't show you that section. That's the section to the Ravel, Pavane to a Dead Princess. And I didn't show that section. I didn't show most of the piece. So that's that section. And do I deal with trauma? Not so much. But have I danced dances about trauma? You bet I have. I could talk more about them, but.
Yeah, I just want to give people a sense of, at least in the incarnation that I saw, which is at Mark's Garage. The other thing too is, and maybe I'll put this, I'll do Jeopardy. I'll put it in the form of a question. To what degree does an audience contribute, or how do you sort of anticipate and then engage the audience with this particular piece as opposed to other pieces?
Timing is a big part of it. And you kind of can feel out, you know, are they with me on this or kind of not, or do I need to, you know, can I really sit in this bit for a couple more beats, or, you know, so a lot of it has to do with timing. Yeah. And a certain amount, energy. Like Mark's Garage is such a great, I mean, it's a great place to perform, because in that instance I had people three sides, so I had to change a little bit the facings of things and how that would work, and because it's so intimate, you the feedback you get is pretty real, and so you can play that.
Yeah, because there's also further intimacy. The thing I was going to comment on is when you went in and saw it, You weren't hiding in the back waiting to make an entrance.
No,
you were actually hanging out in the space, greeting people coming in, having conversations. And it actually was a matter of almost literally saying hi to the last person. And then it just starting.
Mm-hmm.
And of course you were in sort of a warm-up outfit or whatever. So it really was a matter of just almost coming into existence in relation to the people who happened to be in the room, rather than a kind of presentation.
Yeah. And that's been the way I've performed it every time. Even in more formal contexts, I try to, I want to keep it, it's dog years, you know. It shouldn't be all like, I don't know, formal and fourth wall and all that stuff. It needs to be very personal.
Okay. I think, yeah, we've done really well. And I'd just like to have everybody virtually thank Betsy for sharing with us. It's a marvelous piece, and one, I mean, in addition to just being a marvelous piece on its own, that whole notion of the fact that when you're watching it, you realize you're enjoying it in your terms, but you recognize there's so much more going on. And I was thinking in terms of the way you're addressing the audience. Frequently, you have people in the audience that you've danced with, mm-hmm. or maybe your teachers or students. I remember you saying when you were doing it in New York, people busting into hysterical laughter because they were recognizing the quotations along the way. Mm-hmm. So it's a really different experience for every single person who sees it, but it sustains itself through. And we'll finish with one final question, because I think this sort of answers the question, but I'd like to hear Betsy and Mara would as well too. She asks, have you ever developed narrative dance? And have you worked out dance pieces about particular episodes other than dances in your life?
Narrative, you mean like, can you explain that again?
I think what she's getting at is the idea of, you know, something along the lines narratively of a more conventional ballet, or, you know, beginning, middle, and end.
That. Right. You know, it's like a story ballet kind of thing. No, I have never done that. I haven't done that. And I'm not opposed to doing that. It just isn't, I've always been gone in a little bit more abstract way. But Dog Years is as close to narrative as I've done that I can recall right now.
And also mentioning in terms of collaboration, Monkey Waterfall, a dance theater company, is one that strongly foregrounds the notion of narrative, but often does it by assembling different dances together. So over the course of the evening, you get a kind of art.
Yeah, that kind of thing, but not in terms of like, if you're thinking of the story ballets, you know, that have this character as this one. And the work with Monkey Waterfall is much closer to that, but it's not as sort of obvious as a story.
No.
Yeah, it's
no heroes.
Yeah.
No
yeah.
Characters, facets.
Yeah.
Takes.
Yeah. And,
They often did. And so, for example, it'll be a theme. The theme might be addiction, or Betsy did a spectacular piece basically about gun control. Anyway, I would like everybody, as I said, to join me in thanking Betsy. This was everything I hoped for in this, and it's marvelous, and the fact that it'll be available for people, it's a great piece and a great presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming.